It's Team USA. We have two of the best known hunters in the USA after Roebuck in Cumbria. It's shooting top trumps with Tim Pilbeam after rabbits. Welcome to Fieldsports Britain. Take a beautiful British landscape like the Lake District with its plunging hills, its deer-filled woods, its grand traditions of hunting and stalking, and invite a couple of stars of US hunting TV, plus their British mate Jenna, who should know better, and they try to Americanize it.
Piss. Oh, thanks a million.
It smells better. It's really deer piss.
Disgusting.
Does it smell good? That's how we hunt in America.
It's all right, it's scent block, not real wee. But having done the perfume, then comes the makeup.
Oh, you are so... I hate you.
You've been Americanized.
I hate you more than...
Welcome to America.
You blend right in.
I'm feeling awesome. I am feeling awesome.
Now we can go hunting. Very good.
Don't leave me hanging.
We asked Larysa Switlyk, Lindsay, Christensen and Jenna gearing to Cumbria to go stalking with Steve Pym of Cumbria Wild Game. Steve looks after the stalking on a truly enormous acreage in the area.
I think 1,000 at Greystalk, about the same amount at Domain Estate, about 5,000 at Troutbeck and Elfell. And same amount up in Scotland as well, Dumfries.
Now, it is not all fun. We're here to try out the new kite optics that are being promoted by Browning. Before the girls arrive, I stop off at Malmo Guns in Lancashire to pick up a rifle.
You get a lot of people that are on the way up deer stalking in Scotland, grouse shooting in Scotland.
It's a fantastic location, being 1 mile from junction 33 of the M6.
Back in Cumbria, and Jenna gets to go out with Steve Stalker Peter, while Larysa, the main troublemaker, is out with Steve.
He says it's a really, really good spot for deer. However, we're a little early, and the issue is the wind swirling. So what we're going to do is we're going to cut across and use that wall and work in favor of the wind. Give it some time, see if a roe deer will pop out. If not, we might head back out and sit in a high house so we don't miss that chance. It's pretty cool because I've never really hunted with dogs. He's using his dog to kind of sniff out and see if he can smell a deer. So we're just walking slowly and kind of checking the dog to see if he kind of picks up a scent.
Dog may be good, but no deer here defeats even dog. We get a glimpse of deer from the high seat, but a glimpse is it. Eventually, jet lag gets too much for them and they gather on the village green at Greystoke to sleep it off. Not sure what Jenna's doing there, she's only come from Sussex. While they're doing that, let's talk about the kit. If you've got a good idea in hunting or shooting at the moment, you can make some money. The big companies are trying to expand out of their traditional areas. Rifle makers, ammunition manufacturers are all making optics these days, and they're snapping up products from smaller companies. Browning has hooked up with a Belgian optics manufacturer called Kite Optics. This is the 1.6 to 10 by 42 Kite scope. They also make binoculars. And that's not the only innovation. Browning has brought out a new mounting system for scopes. Its Nomad mounts allow you to swap scope and mounts even between rifles without losing zero. The Browning Nomad single mount allows you to fit and replace your scopes and red dots on the same rifle effortlessly in an instant without loss of alignment. Meanwhile, the Browning Nomad Multiple is the first removable adjustable mount system that works between rifles. It allows you to zero with the base rail as well as the crosshairs or dot in the scope. When you adjust the base rail on your second gun during zeroing, you keep the scope setting for your first gun. Now you can swap your scopes between both guns in under 5 seconds without having to readjust. Back at Greystoke, the girls have had a short sleep and they're ready for action again. Lindsay is going out with Steve.
So we actually, as we were driving to the area, we spotted a couple deer off to our left. So I don't know which way we were driving, but out to the left side of the car. And we're like, okay, and he says, that's where we're going. So we'll just get up and try and come in from the opposite way. So parked the vehicle and went through the fence, walked up the road and walked back around and got to where we could see the deer that we had seen from the road originally. And there was actually ended up being four deer does in that area. But we got within 50 yards of one of the does, and so that was pretty cool. And it was, I mean, good to see that 5 minutes into the hunt we were seeing animals, so that was promising. We were walking along like a stone fence and along some trees as well, and we got to like where the corner of the fence met, and we spotted a buck about 150 yards away. And so I actually just used the stone fence to as my rest to take the shot, and so that was pretty cool.
Just wait, reload, come on. We might have backshot it because it went down really quick. Oof, just dropped, didn't it?
And Lindsay gets her first chance to Gralic a row. So who are these girls?
So I actually have three jobs. I teach nursing full-time and then I work at a hospital as a nurse as well part-time, and then I also am a nursing consultant for like a senior living center. The Extreme Huntress Contest is a worldwide hunting competition for women, and it actually started all the way back last April, and we submitted both an application and an essay, and we got a judge's score, and they put 21 of us in the semifinals, so they picked our 21 favorite out of the applications and the essays. And our application included things like all the hunts that we've been on, what weapon that we used, guided or not guided, if we were successful or not, and then any organizations for conservation that we're a part of. Myself and one other girl from the United States were the only two from the U.S., and the other four actually ended up being from Canada that made it into the finals. And then we went to 777 Ranch in Texas in July and competed head-to-head in both hunting and skills competitions. And so we got a judge's score as well as a skills score while we were there. And then online voting opened again until the winner was announced in January. So the whole thing was filmed in a reality web series, so you can watch it at extremehuntress.com. And we went to the Dallas Safari Club in January where they announced the winner there. And I was fortunate enough to win, so Extreme Huntress 2017.
Has there been any downside to the Extreme Huntress competition? I mean, have you had any problems at all?
Yeah, so when I actually made the semifinals, the Idaho News Channel did a story on me, and I had a bunch of like death threats and stuff like that on their like Facebook page. So there were so many of them, they actually removed the story because it was getting like a little out of hand. But after that first semifinals, that whole thing, I had a couple just rude comments here and there, but really if you educate people and if you listen to other people's opinion, whether you agree with it or not, then they kind of develop a respect for you, and then you're able to educate them on, okay, this is why I hunt and this is why we need hunting in the world. So
you've only been in the UK for a few hours, but do you get a sense of the difference between the way hunting is perceived in the US?
Oh yes, a huge difference. Even going through the airport in the passport line, the guy's like, so what brings you to the UK? And I'm like, oh, I'm coming for a hunting trip. And he's like, hunting? You know, people don't like that over here.
I actually certified public accountant. I used to work in New York City. Yeah, crunching numbers. And I really love to travel. I think that's my first passion. I got into law school and I took some time off after I got my CPA exam done and went traveling to Australia and New Zealand. It was supposed to be a 2-month trip and I ended up staying for 6 months. I was just backpacking and I booked myself a hunt, never shot a rifle before. Going out on that first hunt, it's born in me 100%. And everything that when I took that shot, everything went into slow motion. When I came home, my family and my brothers criticized me. They were like, what is wrong with you? Why are you killing animals? There's something mentally wrong with our daughter. You need to go see a psychiatrist. And they actually kind of disowned me for a while. They didn't even talk to me. My one brother, he's like, I can't believe you kill animals. You're a horrible person. I'm like, yeah, but you eat meat. Oh, I buy my meat in the grocery store. I'm like, do you not know where that comes from? Like, it was a disconnect. And when I got shunned by my family, I didn't know where to turn, because here I found my new passion that I loved, but I was being told it was wrong. So it wasn't until I found the hunting world where people accepted me and understood, you know, where their meat comes from and the conservation behind hunting. There's just so much more that goes into hunting than people realize. I found that world and I was like, all right, you know what? If I can change my family's viewpoint on hunting, I can change a lot more people's viewpoint. So that's kind of the whole background of how I started really getting into it and trying to educate people on hunting, and that's the vehicle I used was creating a TV show. In my TV show, Larysa Unleashed, you can find it online on Amazon Prime, YouTube, and I've aired everywhere on NBC Sports. I won an award for Best Show of the Year for Sports Channel. Been on Destination America, Pursuit Channel, Hunt Channel. Right now it's on Tough TV, Action Channel, Wild TV in Canada. And I'm in talks with Discovery Channel. I'm not sure, we'll see.
Lindsay proves that the Browning X-Bolt and Kite Optics can do the job. While Lindsay is out with that setup, Larissa's last stalk of the outing is with Peter and an estate rifle.
There's a big buck and two does kicking about the field the other morning, like, so I haven't touched them, they're still there. Fingers crossed when we go along, we're going to run them in about 10-15 minutes. When we get out with the car up, could we quick run a rifle? Mm-hmm. And then we're out stuck along the fence, I'll cut through a little wood, but be careful because it's quite noisy in the wood.
I spotted a doe.
We see does aplenty. It's strange how elusive bucks become around about the 1st of April, opening of the buck season. Apparently last week you couldn't move for bucks around here. Then one distant buck crosses a field and heads towards a small wood.
It was a younger buck, and so I was like, all right, no, he might stay in the area because he knew there's some does in the area. So, you know, guys kind of get dumb when there's girls around. So I figured, you know, I don't think he's gonna go far. And if we can get around, you know, we might be able to cut him off. That's what I was thinking in my head. Cause I was like, okay, he's going that way, we're going this way, and we're gonna maybe meet back up and maybe close the distance on him. She took off, she left him behind, and he stopped, just, which was a bad mistake on his part, because when he stopped, he threw the sticks up, I threw the gun up, and it was quick. It was within, you know, 2 seconds I had to make that shot. I knew I hit him, but he started running towards me, which freaked me out. I was like, wait, what is going on? So then I started questioning my shot. I'm like, did I make a good shot? Because then he's running towards me, like he's not hurt. And then all of a sudden I see him drop 30 yards later and just right behind those trees. So,
smile for the camera.
It's awesome.
The girls are delighted with their first British roebuck hunt, and so is Steve.
Quite nice bucks, really. I think the girls are really pleased with what they've got. Nice one in velvet. Would have been a good, clean animal. Possibly a bronze medal, I think.
It was a very successful stalking session. I got a roe deer down in velvet. I love how you guys call it deer stalking.
That's brilliant, isn't it?
You see, that just sums up your average American hunting TV star. I thought stocking was something worn on a lady's leg. For more about the X-Belt, go to browning.eu, and for Kite's range of scopes and binoculars, visit kiteoptics.com. Well, I hope you enjoyed watching that as much as I enjoyed making it. Now, someone for whom enjoyment is a dirty word. It's David with the Fieldsports Channel News Stump.
This is Fieldsports Channel News. A Scottish estate is consulting its solicitors after the RSPB tried to pin an eagle death on it. Masked officers from the RSPB intruded on North Glen Bucket Estate in Aberdeenshire looking for a radio-tagged eagle. The estate found it and filmed it healthy and flying. But still, the RSPB issued a release implying the estate had killed it. Our old friend, the German catapult king Jörg Sprawe, is in trouble. Jörg posted a film showing how easy it is to stab a commercially available stab vest. The Mail Online ran an article about it, and YouTubers hit Jörg with a community guidelines rap. His supporters have left thousands of comments on the website complaining about the report. There's a new shooting kit auction site in the UK. Boltandbraces.co.uk has launched the service, which is charging a flat 5% commission fee. It does not sell guns. Another big game hunting American dentist is in the news. But this story is more complicated than that of Cecil the lion hunting Walter Palmer from Minnesota. This shaky video shows a secretly filmed lunch that Pennsylvania-based dentist Larry Rudolph held with the now late John Whipple, both of them Safari Club International presidents in their time. Rudolph had been stripped of his SCI hunting awards and thrown out of the SCI for using his presidency to commit adultery. He's contesting that through the courts. Meanwhile, the SCI has issued a federal invasion of privacy lawsuit for the film. In Brazil, a snake has made a schoolboy error of eating a porcupine. This video on YouTube shows an injured boa constrictor pierced by dozens of white quills, which then has to defend itself from a barking dog. And finally, Donald Trump Jr. has gone fishing and opened a can of worms. He went shark fishing in Florida with YouTube channel Black Tip H, caught a bunch of bluefish jacks and hooked six sharks. They also had a giant hammerhead attack two of the black tips. Now PETA wants catch and release banned. You are now up to date with Fieldsports Channel News. Stalking the stories, fishing for facts.
Thank you, David. Now for a heated debate, propellant or air power. Let's look at the evidence.
Gunpowder, you know, it's proper stuff, you know.
Look at mine. Mine looks like a proper rifle.
And so does mine.
How can you spend that much money on an air rifle? So that is going to be cheaper, better value for money.
Price of ammunition?
I'm about a tenner for 500.
I'm about 45 quid for 100. That's yours?
Yeah, I like that.
It's a high-stakes game of top trumps. Tim smoking Pilbeam against Chris Air Power Kemp, who just so happens to be service manager at Air Arms. They're comparing the attributes of a Browning T-Bolt 22 rimfire and an FAC Air Arms 510. It's a well-matched pairing, but do you need just one of them, or both? Tim has already enjoyed a few weeks shooting the Air Arms around his farm. The biggest benefit being that, with caution, you can point this air rifle skywards, something not to be entertained with a rimfire or centrefire.
This brings back memories going back a long, long time. And I spent about 5 or 6 years shooting sparrows, starlings, magpies around the farm. Of course, nowadays you wouldn't do that, but in those days we had cattle sheds everywhere. We had hundreds and hundreds of sparrows making messes all over the gates. And I spent all my early years shooting small birds. And just doing this now with this air rifle and just shooting a pigeon off the top of the building just brings back all those memories. I haven't done it for a long, long time. It's quite fun, actually. It's just slightly different. I'm a rifle person, and with a 22 rifle, or, you know, I can't do that. It's not safe, but with an air rifle, you can do that.
There's a nostalgia element for Tim, but like his quarry list, we've all moved on, and so have the style and capabilities of a modern-day air rifle.
I've had it for about a month. I've shot a few pigeons with it.
Yep.
And I just need you to tell me about it, because I'm quite intrigued, actually. So.
Well, I think you're getting the same results you would out of your rimfire anyway.
Yeah.
You know, it's saying that I do like shooting above the rimfire, mainly, really, see, the running costs of an air rifle. Once you've got the air rifle and you've got your filling kits and stuff like that.
Yeah, but you need your filling kit. You need a damn great aqua lung behind
how
you.
Many
you
know, how long, many times you know? Are you going to go out and shoot 30 rabbits and carry them all back with you?
So there's a Air Arms S510 extra FAC, and yeah. It's a lightweight one, isn't it? Is that right?
Lightweight, yeah. You've got the lightweight stock on here.
So that's a light stock. Made of poplar wood as opposed to walnut?
Yes.
So it makes it a lot lighter?
Yes, it does. Okay. Yeah. Also, features you've got on the rifle, you've got your side lever cocking, which you have got on all the Air Arms S510 rifles anyway. And also the lovely little power adjuster on the side. You can drop that down to around about 8 foot-pounds on minus settings.
So you twiddle it on the other side there?
Knob here, yeah.
Yep, okay.
Down to about 8 foot-pounds. So you can go and do a bit of barn work and stuff like that, damaging the roof.
Yep.
Go outside, turn it right up, and you can do a 50, 60 yard bunny.
Wow, okay, so that's impressive. Yep.
Yeah, it comes as a multi-shot. So you've got a 10 shot magazine that comes with it as well. You get the same results out of this as you do, I'm sure, out of your rimfire.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, I'll show you a proper rifle.
Okay.
So one of the best parts about this rifle is the double helix magazine. And if I show you, you see those bullets that go around in a figure of eight.
Right.
And it fits beautifully into the rifle. It's nice and flush.
I think it's probably fair to say the rimfire is generally a wee bit cheaper than an FAC air rifle.
But, yeah? but the running cost on a rimfire is...
Okay, fine.
Today we are off rabbiting. Okay, not so many of those up the trees. First up will be Chris. He has about 30 shots per fill. Tim can go all night, but none of us want to see that. As the light goes, we start hitting the bunnies. And for anyone in any doubt that air rifles don't kill, Chris makes some excellent shots with Tim rangefinding in the passenger seat.
We were shooting along the side of a main road for quite a bit of the time. And to me, there was no problems with safety whatsoever with this, was there?
Exactly. Now, you look through your scope, and it was all in the back of your mind to see what's going on beyond your shot, obviously.
Yeah.
Even with something like this, would you use your rimfire in the same places? No,
I could not use a rimfire for that, most definitely. Most of the shots, I was actually range finding when you were shooting. Most of the shots were between, say, 25 and probably about 45. One shot was actually 50 metres away, which quite, I mean, to me, you know, for me, a rimfire would probably be out to 50 metres, maybe maximum, maybe 60, but, you know, still very capable downrange, you know,
shooting.
And you were shooting them in the head, and they just, when you actually shot them in the head, they dropped very, very quickly, didn't they?
That's the same job as your rimfire does.
Yeah, yeah.
But a lot safer.
Yeah.
Now it's your turn, you have a go.
Yeah, see how we get on, shall we?
Next up is Tim and the T-Bolt with his new kite scope. He has more punch, but is it quieter? Possibly, but that's not making any difference to us tonight. We pick up most of the rabbits, but not all. They have another role to play.
Tonight's an interesting night because you notice we're actually not picking the rabbits up. And some people say, why are you doing this? The farmer wants to leave a few out for the foxes. And these guys will be out tomorrow night with the centrefires to sort the foxes out. So it's just one of those things we do. We're taking some back home with us for the pot and some will be left on the ground, hopefully to allow them to shoot more foxes tomorrow night. And that's the plan. So that's where we do it tonight.
With the mist rolling in, Tim has a final word on the powder versus air debate.
That's interesting. That was about 60 yards away, aimed about just above his head, quite honestly, and a nice headshot. So to me, that's the biggest difference between the air rifle and the 2-2 rimfire, is that downrange knockdown power. And I think it's very, very apparent tonight that it's quite a big difference between the two. But out to about 40, 45 yards, maybe 50 yards, I think they are very, very similar. Now, I think, as I said to somebody the other day, I think it takes a better shot with an air rifle. You need to be a more skillful shot with an air rifle. Now, I think the air rifle is actually quite a bit quieter. It's easy to shoot, lovely trigger. So, at the moment, I think they are very different, but also there's a lot of similarities as well. So it's been a very interesting experience.
Both of these rifles are very nice bits of engineering and deliver results. You need an FAC for both anyway, so buy both. It'll stop any squabbles and things getting out of hand. Thank you, Tim, and thank you, Chris. And if you have a view, please leave it in the comments below. Now from a marsh in Sussex to the wider world of hunting and shooting on YouTube, it is Hunting YouTube. This is Hunting YouTube, which aims to show the best hunting and shooting videos that YouTube has to offer. PD Safaris strikes a fabulously vampiric note with this film, Hunting Wild Boar Poland 2017. They're in Castle Chocha in Poland for a driven day. It's snowy, gothic, and there are lots of animals. Team Wild teams up with Danish clothing manufacturer Deerhunter to go duck hunting in Denmark. This is not the yee-haw Team Wild of old. It's lots of slow-mo and big skies, a lovely wild duck shoot, and the editor skillfully gets around the problem that the ducks don't really turn up until it's dark. Feel your pain, man. I've done this kind of hunt in the mountains of California and I love it. Whether or not you shoot the bear or the cat at the end, the hound work is superb. This is JR hunting after a mountain lion. So here's a link to the first film in the whole Extreme Huntress Competition that Lindsay, Christensen won in January. You can watch it all on YouTube. Meanwhile, Larysa has her own channel, Larysa Unleashed. In this video, she travels to Spain for the Spanish Ibex of a lifetime. Not Shooting Boar is big on YouTube this week. This is a popular kill it, cook it channel called Deer Meat for Dinner, as American as pork and apple pie, and I say pork and apple because in this film he is after hogs in Florida. He only has a 2-2 and shoots, he reckons, 6 inches high, so thank goodness the hogs win. At the other end of America, Gary English takes to the backcountry of Alaska to hunt true trophy moose. Less than an hour after setting up camp, he and his guide bump into a 61-inch wide bull. And finally, another one from the USA, this with Henry and Lakeisha Outdoors, Halo from Tennessee. Henry is an elder with a local church, so don't be surprised there is a God element to this. Their daughter Angle goes on a deer and hog hunt with the Beverly Woods Fishing and Hunting with Kids Foundation, and she has a cute laugh. That's it for this week. I have put all these films into a playlist for you. Click on the link or go to bit.ly/huntingyoutube384. If you have a YouTube film you would like us to pop into the weekly top 8, email me the link, charlie@fieldsportschannel.tv. Also out this month is Club Digweed, and George has just come back from South Africa. On this month's Club Digweed, George talks through his recent trip to South Africa and the extraordinary setting for one of the competitions.
It was one of their focal points of the shoot, and it certainly created a lot of talk. A Zimbabwean shooter that won it shot very, very well.
He explains why he shoots white gold, but always has a few black golds up his sleeve for those edge-on targets. He then puts that into practice with a left-to-right crosser.
Most importantly is our feet position, and our feet position has to be where you're going to open yourself out to keep your shoulders square.
George also has some new branded merchandise in his online shop. It's all on this month's Club Digweed. For more information on how to become a member or to download the show, go to georgedigweed.com. Well, that is it for this week. If you haven't done so, please pop over to our website, fieldsportschannel.tv, where you can click to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, subscribe to us on YouTube, or pop your email address into our register page and we'll contact you about this show. Fieldsports Britain, it's at 7 p.m. UK time every Wednesday. And this has been Fieldsports Britain. Good hunting, good shooting, good fishing, and goodbye.